morning, everyone.
Morning.
This microphone's a bit quiet. Make it louder. I'll test if you can hear me. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Well done. We are going to start our service today with our first hymn. We've got two that are not in our books today, so they're on a separate sheet of paper. And we're going to stand and sing, first of all, ye choirs of New Jerusalem. Would you stand if you feel able to sing? Sunday of Easter. Now, if you would like to please be seated or kneel if you prefer for our prayers of penitence. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Like Mary at the empty tomb, we fail to grasp the wonder of your presence. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Like the disciples behind locked doors, we are afraid to be seen as your followers. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Like Thomas in the upper room, we are slow to believe. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you feel feel able, would you like to stand as we sing, celebrating our forgiveness with the words of the Gloria? Grant us so to put away the leaven of malice and wickedness, that we may always serve you in pureness of living and truth, through the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please do be seated for our first readings.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the temple police had brought the apostles, they made them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in his name, yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teachings, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and saviour, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 150, the response is, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord."
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Oh, praise God in his holiness. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Praise him with the blast of the trumpet. Praise him upon the harp and the lyre. Praise him with timbrel and dancers. Praise him upon the strings and pipe.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Praise him with ringing cymbals. Praise him upon the clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Alleluia.
Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
from the book of Revelations. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia. Grace to you, and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. This is the word of the Lord.
Brings to us our gospel reading and preaches to us this morning. We're going to sing again. This is the second hymn that's printed on the sheets here. It's one of my favourite Easter hymns, actually. We don't hear it all that often. It's called Now the Green Blade Rises. If you feel able to, would you like to stand as we sing?
First day of the week, a and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called a twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the marks of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the marks of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen me and have yet come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight. Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Please do be seated. Christ is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Well done. I could hear that. Today is Orthodox Easter. So people in Ukraine and throughout the Orthodox world are today celebrating Easter and greeting each other with very similar words. I think they say, "Christ is risen," and you reply, "He is indeed," without the alleluias. But it's a very important festival, especially this year in Ukraine. It is still Easter here. And the good news of the gospel is here and now, in this building, for our joy and our thanksgiving. More importantly for us as Christ's body here on earth is the call to witness to that good news. It can be a hard ask, as we've seen from Thomas. In today's gospel, faith is not easily won on a personal level, let alone bearing witness in a hostile world. I came to realise that I, like many of you, have spent the last 2 years in a state of mild anxiety. I wake in the night thinking not of death and COVID, not of war and refugees, but of total irrelevancies. The weeds untackled in the garden. What shall I cook today? And worst of all, is it my day to fetch William from school and I've forgotten? Then the thoughts churn around. Why am I telling you this, and is it relevant to those of you who have much greater anxieties and many more dreadful tragedies to face? And why at Easter, that time of joy and thanksgiving? Fear, anxiety, doubt, disbelief, loss are all part of our human existence. They were shared by Jesus and the disciples. And yet that gospel message has survived through opposition and torture. It is here over 2,000 years later. And we have that imperative command to witness to it. Christ died for our forgiveness, and he has overcome death. So I started to think, what are we to witness to? In his Easter Day sermon, Archbishop Justin Welby said that the plan to send asylum seekers to Rwanda raised serious ethical questions and cannot stand the judgment of God. His concerns were echoed by other bishops and faith leaders. Whether we agree with these sentiments or hold the opposite view, it was a bold and challenging statement. He also challenged the government on the issues of poverty, saying, "Families across this country are waking up to cold homes and empty stomachs as we face the greatest cost of living crisis we have known." In Ukraine, President Zelensky and the Ukrainian people continue to resist the Russian invasion, and thousands of innocent lives have been lost. As I said earlier, Ukraine is a very religious nation. Most people will be going to church today if they can. And I don't know if any of you listened to Radio 4 this morning, but if you did, you would have heard the service from the Ukrainian Cathedral in London, which apparently was the first building that they put up when they came across, these are Ukrainian refugees, after, I think, the Second World War, when lots of them had to flee from Russia again at that time. It must be hard for them, trying to celebrate the joy and forgiveness of Easter in the midst of what's happening. The head of Ukraine's independent Orthodox Church, Metropolitan Epiphany, said, "The war that Russia has imposed on us and the whole world did not begin with missiles and bombs. It began with deception and untruth and lies." Religious leaders commenting on matters that are too big for us to influence or change. Are they right to bear witness in this way? And is it something that we should also do? I cannot answer that on your behalf, but there are positive things out there that we should praise. Again, going back to Radio 4, there was a lot of reporting from Ukraine, and one of the things I took out of it was a young woman who said, "What has happened throughout this is that we have become closer together. We have cared more for one another as a community, and we have cared more for God." And I think possibly that's something that we experienced during the worst of COVID. So perhaps we can take that on board. And I was very moved by an article in Church Times this week from a young English doctor, Laura Douglas Beveridge, who took 3 weeks' leave from St. Thomas's Hospital to work in Lviv as an emergency medical specialist. She admits to fear as they worked underground to help pregnant or wounded people. She says, "The Easter story took on a fresh perspective as the gift God gives of hope in new life is even more real to me after having had this experience. Nearer home, I give thanks that so many people have opened their homes to Ukrainian refugees, although part of me wishes that this was a wider net to house other nationalities escaping from similar horrors. I give thanks too for all who work to ease the burdens of poverty and homelessness through helping refugees, through food banks, and through many other projects. Jesus not only preached, but went about doing good, especially for the poor and the downtrodden. Bearing witness is not just talk. Let's have a look now at two of today's readings. They give us two pictures of the disciples. The first in the Gospel we'll see in the immediate aftermath of the crucifixion, as the disciples cower in fear in the upper room. We have the story of the absent Thomas, who refuses to believe until he himself sees Jesus. The second is the bravery of the disciples as they are brought before the high priests, when Peter and the others stand in defiance at being told not to teach in Jesus' name. What a change from fear and doubt to bearing witness to all that Jesus taught. The journey of the disciples from doubt to faith and from faith to action is our journey too. Are we still at the beginning, trying to hide the fact that we believe in Jesus, perhaps even from ourselves? Or are we in the middle, struggling with believing? In this story from John's Gospel, Jesus gives his blessing to people like us, people who believe in him without having physically seen him. We are called to be the kind of disciple Peter became in the end. Someone who's brave enough to speak about their faith and to tell people about God. This may lead to controversy, as it has for Archbishop Welby, but it does make us all sit up, think, and question our own views, and perhaps to look at all that troubles us through the eyes of Jesus. Peter and the others will go on, outside the New Testament record, to die for their faith, the ultimate proof of their commitment to the resurrection. However, there are also little more ordinary proofs of their commitment to the truth. Years before, they left their own lives behind to follow the man who they later said rose from the dead. Yet they let him down when it mattered most. But in the end, they turned back and became witnesses once more. We too can recognize this behavior, take it to heart and imitate it. Our witness may be prayer, as we talk to God. Or it may involve speaking out where we see injustice. Or it may involve positive action, where that is possible. So finally, let us remember the message of love, joy, forgiveness, and hope. That is Easter. And in the words of Psalm 150, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Another way to witness. Christ is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Amen.
Feels comfortable to do so, would you please stand as we declare our faith with the words of the Creed on page 5. So let us declare our faith in God. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sakes, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please do be seated again as we pray together. Gracious God, in this Eastertide, we bring to you all the prayers of our hearts. We ask for your guidance, clear guidance, for inspiration, for the ways in which we are to best witness as Christians. Help us as we do our best to live our faith and to share our faith. And we ask for the courage and the humility that we need at different times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray, Lord, for all those who are unwell today. In the quiet, we pray for those known to us in need of God's healing. We pray as well for those who've asked specifically for prayer, for Anne, Christine, Roland, Catherine, Neil, Patricia, Malcolm, Janet, Bina, Betty, Jenny and Keith. We pray, Lord, for your healing in the measures that people need it, and that you will bring those who are struggling particularly today with anxiety and associated conditions, that you would bring them peace and their own healing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we pray for everyone who's grieving today, particularly those preparing for funerals or memorial services at this time, for those who've had to make these arrangements recently, and those who've been reminded strongly today of the loss of a loved one, perhaps the anniversary of the loss of a loved one. We pray for all those who are grieving, Lord, and ask that for those who today feel surrounded by the shadow of death, that you would bring your light and your hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, Lord, we pray for our world. We pray for peace. We pray for Ukraine, for those who are trapped, needing to leave and needing help. We pray for those who are bringing medical aid and supplies to those who desperately need it, and pray that this could arrive safely to where it's needed. And we pray for other parts of the world that are war-torn, or full of chaos, or struck by famine. Sometimes we don't hear of these places in the news. We pray, Lord, for your peace to come, for the voices of the poorest and the most vulnerable to be heard and listened to. Give great wisdom, Lord, to our own government here in the UK and leaders of the world abroad. Change their hearts, Lord, to peace, not searching for power. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia, the peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Alleluia. Let's offer each other a sign of God's peace. That could be waving, bowing, elbows, shaking hands. Peace to everyone at home joining us as well. Peace with you all. Peace to everyone. Send some little hearts to the people at home. Peace be with you all. And as we finish sharing the peace together, we're going to sing again. This time in our hymn books, we are going to sing number 373, Jesus Lives, 373. Darkness, Jesus came as your light with your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body, given for you all." Jesus then gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, "This is my blood, shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." This is our story.
This is our song.
Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. This is our story.
This is our song. Hosanna in the highest.
Send your spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with open eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessings and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen.
Please do be seated. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever."
Lord, our hearts are hungry for you. Give us this bread always.
Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us.
Jesus, bearer of sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us your peace.
Alleluia. Our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
And we pray. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to your coming.
Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared.
We will not forget even to eat crumbs from your table.
But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him,
and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom.
Amen.
Just a reminder, as we receive communion today, we have brought back the chalice with wine. You're welcome to receive communion just as the bread. You're also welcome to receive the wine if you would like it. If you prefer not to, that is completely fine and just as valid. And you're also welcome, of course, to come forward for a blessing if you would prefer that, to receive the communion. Thank you. Jesus Christ, you've assured your children of eternal life, and in baptism have made us one with him. Deliver us from the death of sin, and raise us to new life in your love, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise, that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gates of glory. May we who share Christ's body share his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to us. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set for us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Spirit of God, we will always see you again, heavenly. Make us one in heart and mind. Make us one in love, humble, caring, selfless, sharing. Spirit of God, fill our hearts with your purpose and love. Amen. Some information to share. I'm going to do that now. I'm going to start by publishing some bans of marriage and then share some other notices with you. So, two sets today. I publish the bans of marriage between Mark Thompson and Catherine Irene Brown, both of this parish, and between Jonathan Gordon Millard and Claire Louise Sutton, both of this parish, and these are for the third time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. Brilliant. Let's pray for these two couples. We thank you, Lord, for the love that Mark and Catherine and Jonathan and Claire have for each other. We ask that you bless them as they prepare for their wedding day and in the years to come. Amen. That's brilliant. Those couples will be getting married soon, about 2 months' time. Before I start talking about notices, anyone else got any notices today? You wish to share, Peter? Go on. Now's your chance.
It's a long walk.
It's a long way from the back of your own.
Just lobbed you the microphone. Yeah.
I just thought, in the light of Anne's wonderful words this morning, a very quick update about a refugee situation, which is perhaps closer to home than you would imagine, certainly than I imagine. There's a hostel against the wall of Wakefield Prison. There are 300 asylum seekers in there. There's a hotel, the Cedar Court Hotel, south of Wakefield. There are 200 asylum seekers in there. That sounds okay, because those places are transit places from which refugees, asylum seekers, should then be placed into semi-permanent accommodation. Through our friends at Lofthouse and their wonderful cafe, I've got to know about 8 families who are in the Wakefield situation. I only know them because Sarah knew that I spoke Spanish and had been to El Salvador. But they're just 8 families out of the 120 rooms in that hospital. And the worrying thing is that they have been there for anything from 5 to 8 months. One family to a room in a situation where they were led to believe by the Home Office prior to the pandemic that they'd be moved on in a matter of weeks. The children are not in school. That's a policy decision as it stands. And the great news is that because of the Lofthouse Cafe, they're getting love, refreshments, time with the children. It's a wonderful, loving action that's going on there. Now, how can we support them? We don't know yet. I'm learning as I go about the support that they are getting from the Home Office and from City of Sanctuary, which is the Wakefield support organisation. But I'm sure there will be a way that we can support them. And as Anne has said, we can always support with prayer. So would you pray for all those asylum seekers who are near to home, and that could include the Holiday Inn at Alton, which is also being used for asylum seekers. They are on our doorstep, they're stuck in difficult circumstances, and I'm sure the prayer will help them, and particularly our friends at Lofthouse, who are working very hard to support them.
Thank you. One way we are supporting them is by having a Spanish speaker who can help them to communicate where there's a language barrier. And it might be that some of you speak a second language very well, and that's something that you might like to help with, communicating with people where English is definitely not their first language, and perhaps they sometimes only have a few words of English when they arrive desperate in this country. So if you do speak another language well, and that's something you're interested in, come and have a word with Peter or with me, and we can talk to you about how that might be possible to get involved or ways to find out more. It is our annual meeting tomorrow night, our APCM. This is where we elect our church wardens, PCC members. It's also where we have our report from the year past, from 2021. So it's not the report up to today, it's to the end of 2021. There are some copies of this report, I think they're just at the back, is that right? Please take a copy if you're interested. Find out what's been going on. Any questions that you've got, pass them on to me or to Anne or Peter, or we'll point you towards someone who can help answer them. And if you're able to come tomorrow to the meeting, it's 7:30 in church. I was double checking that. Yeah, 7:30 in church tomorrow night. Come along if you can, please. We continue with our communion on Tuesdays in our church hall, that's at 10. After that, straight away, is a coffee morning where there are, the hope is that as families, particularly from Ukraine, start to arrive in the village and local area, that this can be a place they can gather together, a shared language, share resources, and just a place to meet with like-minded people or people who've been through similar situations, and that's 11 till 12 on Tuesdays. Don't think I need to go through every other single thing. What I will mention, we are starting our Bible study groups again, our home groups. If that's something you'd be interested in getting involved with, you might have come along in the past, you might want to come along for the first time, let us know. We can see if we want to start a new group as well as a continuing group that's going on. Anything else I should be saying? Do have a look at all the other things that are on here. Anything I've forgotten? I always do. What is it I've forgotten this week? Someone tell me.
No.
Okay. Hopefully we're okay. Let's stand and sing our final hymn in that case, number 77, Christ Triumphant, Ever Reigning. 77.
Thank you.
brings new hope and a new future, fill you with his new life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ.
Amen.